A very good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Katie Clark. Our first item is consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Charities, References and Documents, Miscellaneous Amendment, Scotland Regulations 2024. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and the purpose of the instrument is to amend existing regulations to ensure consistency across different legal forms of charities in relation to information included in certain documents. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Okay, I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to know the instrument? Thank you. So our next item of business this morning is the consideration of an affirmative statutory instrument, the Disability Assistance for Older People, Scotland Regulations 2024. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve them before they come into force. So I welcome to the meeting Shirley-Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, and I also welcome her officials from the Scottish Government, Peter Bell, Policy Manager, Pension Age Disability Payment, Daniel Blakey, Solicitor, and Meg Sidney, Disability Benefits Policy Team Leader, Scottish Government, who's attending in lieu of Helen Spears, I believe. Okay, fine. So thank you very much for joining us today. So following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in the upcoming agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. And I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you and good morning, Convener. These regulations enable us to commence delivery of pension age disability payment for new applicants from the 21st of October, initially in Argyll and Bute, Highlands, Orkney Islands, City of Aberdeen and the Shetland Islands. We will then introduce pension age disability payment with one further phase before rolling out nationally on the 22nd of April 2025. Our priority, as always, is the safe and secure transfer to pension age disability payment, meaning the rules for eligibility are broadly similar to attendance allowance. However, the passage of these regulations will enable us to take a very different and more compassionate approach to the delivery of disability assistance for older people. Across all forms of disability assistance, we have heard time and time again that the previous DWP system is complicated, stigmatising and can be difficult to access. The recent proposals by the DWP are yet another example of the UK Government's punitive approach to social security, and we completely reject the heartless proposals that have been made. In Scotland, we actively and vigorously encourage people to apply for the benefits they're eligible for and strive to make applying for them as easy as possible, supporting them at every step. To this end, people will be able to apply in the way that works best for them, whether that's online, by post, over the phone or face-to-face, ensuring that no one is digitally excluded from the assistance they are entitled to. Our local delivery staff will provide one-to-one support, including assistance to complete application forms and taking forward any follow-up actions. Establishing a third-party representative is being streamlined into the application process, and this means that people who require this can gain support from friends and relatives from the outset while maintaining their financial independence. We continue to fund an independent advocacy service which further supports people in accessing social security. We are establishing a system that is rooted in trust with a focus on person-centred decision-making. So where needed, Social Security Scotland will support people in identifying supporting information or they will gather it for them. As with our other disability benefits, when making a determination of entitlement, equal consideration will be given to all sources of information. Applications from people with a terminal illness will be fast-tracked so they can access the support they are entitled to as quickly as possible. We will be using our devolved Scottish Government definition of terminal illness. This removes the arbitrary 12-month timescale currently used by the DWP and allows us to get expedited help to those who need it most. The 160,000 people in Scotland already getting attendance allowance don't need to do anything. These regulations make provisions so that we can begin transferring their awards to Social Security Scotland and on to pension age disability payment. This will happen in phases from early next year. The process happens automatically and makes sure everyone will continue to be paid the right amount at the right time. This is the fifth benefit transfer process we have designed, and our processes continue to improve with experience, and we have had good feedback from those whose awards have already transferred, with a significant majority of people in a recent survey saying that they felt informed and reassured about the case transfer process. Our approach for these regulations has been supported by SCOS and many responses to our public consultations and our ongoing engagement with stakeholders. From day one, pension age disability payment will offer an entirely new experience for older disabled people in Scotland, an experience which reflects the human right to social security and the ethos of dignity, fairness and respect, now so firmly embedded in our social security system. And I welcome the opportunity to assist the committee in its consider of the regulations today.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and we will now move on to questions. Our questions will be directed to you, but you are, of course, welcome to invite any officials to respond, should you wish to do so. So I'm going to bring in Ros McCall, first of all, on theme one, which is on the changes after case transfer. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and everyone. Thank you very much for the opening comments. I've made a few notes. I also note that in the response to SCOS, that the Scottish Government's response stated that we will deliver what we will deliver on day one will not be the limit of our aspirations, and we will review the benefit over time to make such improvements that are practical and affordable, in line with principles which I totally understand and accept. So, does the Scottish Government expect to complete the transfer completely by December 2025? And given those comments, what preparatory work has the Scottish Government doing on changes that might be possible after case transfer?
So we do expect to complete our case transfer process for this benefit, and I would say we're on track for the case transfer for all of our benefits by the end of 2025. One of the areas that we are always keen to look at within social security is around continuous improvement. So I appreciate the government often says a lot about how we are very proud of what's happened in the social security system and we think it is performing well. But as I've also said, I'm also very cognisant of the fact that it's a new system and we will learn from the processes, and that means that we have to be open to that continuous improvement and to change. So once we've completed the case transfer process and we have that period of stabilisation, as part of our continual improvement process, we will of course consider how this payment can be developed over time. We will look to see if there are opportunities to make improvements, and as I hope the committee would wish us to do, this will be evidence-led based on the client experience of having pension age disability payment as we move through that case transfer process to see what needs to be done to change things as we move along.
Thank you. Just as a sort of follow-up there, Cabinet Secretary, we've had suggestions put forward with support with mobility and various options. Would that be something that you'd be willing to look at?
Well, I've met campaigners on this issue for many years now, since we first began discussing social security disability benefits, and I've always said to them that the government is very keen to look at what changes can be made. There are two areas in particular that we need to look at as we go through that process. One is the cost factor of that, and I'm happy to go into that in further detail on the motability section, or we can come on to that later, Convener, but I think it's important that we do have that on the record. The other aspect of that is the ability for those that have a devolved benefit to still continue to be able to receive the reserved passported benefits. And those are the two areas, not the only two areas, but two areas that we're exceptionally keen to make sure that we're keeping in mind. And to be open with stakeholders about the financial context that the government is in, but also to make sure that there are no unintended consequences to what might seem like a good idea, but maybe a disbenefit if it has an impact on a passported benefit.
Thank you, that's very helpful. So could you also explain further why the six-month qualifying period cannot be shortened, and how does it meet the needs of older people diagnosed with long-term conditions?
So the disability benefits which we have are there to ensure that we are supporting those that have a long-term disability or health conditions, and the qualifying periods are there to ensure that assistance is targeted for those that have the long-term disabilities or health conditions. And we have the qualifying periods there because if we didn't, then we could get into a situation where those with short-term conditions would be eligible and receive assistance for short periods of time. That's not the way that the current DWP system is set up, and that is one aspect that we feel it was right to transfer over to make sure that we are focusing our support on those that have a long-term disability or health condition. While there's a longer qualifying period for PADP rather than CDP and ADP, I would point out that sits hand in hand with the fact there's no qualifying period into the future as there is with CDP and ADP. So that's one of the reasons why we have the slight difference in approach here. One of the areas, of course, again, I would come back to on this, is around whether any change in this would impact on the DWP's current position to ensure automatic passporting. So if we had a shorter qualifying period, then would that run into difficulty? Now, that has not been tested, but I raise that as a concern that we have in our mind, particularly as we go through case transfer, and to ensure that people that are applying for the benefits have the same rules at that point, and therefore no danger of getting into that difficulty with the DWP.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. And continuing on with that theme, Cabinet Secretary, I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your colleagues. Yeah, it's following on. So the committee's been told by DWP that it would, open inverted commas, find a way to ensure people receive the correct entitlements in reserve benefits. Does that alter your thinking in regard to the risk of any divergence from attendance allowance rules compared to the new rules up here in Scotland?
So I think it was a very welcome evidence session from the DWP. I think it's probably the most reassuring statement on this issue that we've heard from the DWP in a public setting. It's clearly something that I discussed with DWP ministers in our private meetings. So that is good, and I think it demonstrates for me, convener, the benefit of the DWP giving evidence to the committee, because this is a shared system that we have. So I very much welcome that. What I would say in a slight caveat to that is, what does find a way mean? Because if find a way means that, for example, and this is purely hypothetical, you may find a person would get the reserve benefit, but only if they went through another application form or only if they went through another type of assessment, then yes, the DWP's found a way, but it's found a way that is very detrimental to the client. So as we look to make changes in Scotland, it is very important that we continue to work very closely with the DWP to test out what that find a way means, because we may get to the point where the clients or the stakeholders who are asking for a change would actually see it as a disbenefit if the find a way is problematic for the people that they're there to support. So I very much welcome what was there and what was said, but I would put that caveat on it that I think we can't just immediately assume that we can do absolutely everything up here Because, again, for example, if we were to make very substantial changes to any of the disability benefits that greatly increased the number of people that were eligible up here that would not be eligible down south, then we are asking the DWP to pay out benefits that they would not be paying out to people in those similar situations in England. Now, that's a decision then for them to do with what they will, but we need to have that in mind as we look to the changes that we might wish to make.
So I suppose to some extent this is an academic discussion until we actually either government tries this out. I mean, obviously you have conversations with DWP in private. Has there been any fleshing out of find a way in those conversations? Have you tested them on, say, if we do X, what would happen?
So we need to get past the case transfer process first. And I think at this point, more of the conversations that we're having with the DWP are because of the changes that they're about to make in reserved benefits. So, for example, if the DWP, following some of the recent pronouncements from the UK government, reduce the ability for those with mental illness to qualify for PIP, but we still have that within ADP, which we absolutely are committed to doing, then what does that mean? Does that mean that the UK government would make any changes to the way that they're treating people that qualify? So given the real and present danger that we may have given some of the recent pronouncements from the DWP and changes to PIP and changes to work capability assessments, that's where the conversations have been lying at the moment.
OK, that's really helpful. You've touched on the elephant in the room, and that is money. So to what extent is the cost the single biggest factor limiting the possible changes to disability benefits?
I wouldn't consider it the single biggest factor, but it is undeniably something that needs to be looked at. I would consider the principles that are in the Social Security Act that Mr Balfour was on committee when we passed, to be our touchstone when we're looking at potential changes. Do any changes still ensure we have a system that has dignity, fairness and respect, or how can we build more of that into the system? But if I can give some examples, convener, of why cost does need to be looked at, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has provided a full costing for pension age disability payment in the December 2023 publication, with the 24-25 expenditure estimated to be £754.9 million, rising to £918.4 million by 28-29. Costings for the financial year include a projected £87.1 million additional investment in Scotland when compared to the funding received from the block grant. Now, Mr Balfour, as we're in some of our more combative nature in the chamber, tells me that nothing has changed. I could point to him that the Fiscal Commission clearly think it has, because they think it's going to cost us an extra £87.1 million because of the changes that we've made. For example, in the new terminal illness definition, introduction of short-term assistance and the improved supported application process. So even making the changes that we have that are not in essence to do with eligibility but how you run a system has already built in an additional cost of £87.1 million.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, and that was helpful. So moving on now to theme two, which is mitigations for mobility component. I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Well, following on from Jeremy Balfour's mentioning of money, as you probably gathered, we had a number of witnesses looking for a mobility component for PAPDP. So I suppose, well, first of all, just to throw that out, what is your reaction to the suggestion there should be a mobility component?
So as I think I said earlier, I've had a number of meetings on this issue, including one pretty recently, with Age Scotland, the Alliance and others to talk about this issue, and I very much do respect their opinions on it. What I would say to them is that this is one of the areas where we absolutely do need to think about the cost. We undertook significant work exploring the feasibility of introducing a mobility component during the early development of pension age disability payment, and the analysis at that time found that it would cost an additional £580 million annually. Now, that was based on figures from 2020-21. So with the ageing population operating during a period of high inflation, we now think that the mobility rates being included, that cost is now in excess of £700 million per annum. That figure doesn't make allowances for the caseload being any higher than was projected at that time. So it isn't a full new estimation, but it does take account of inflation. So I think that really does highlight the cost of where we are on this. What I also would say, though, while I appreciate where the stakeholders are coming from on this, there are a number of ways which there is additional support for mobility needs for older disabled people. That, of course, includes our free bus travel that's universally available to anyone over the age of 60. The companion bus pass also includes free personal care available in Scotland, and that can support with a number of needs, including immobility problems. And although receipt of the pension age disability payment won't provide automatic entitlement to the Blue Badge scheme, eligible disabled people can apply for that vital support through the local authority. So there are different circumstances, I would say, about this age cohort when compared to people of working age, which I do think does present a different case. So while I respect where the stakeholders are coming from a cost issue, and also because of those different circumstances on that age cohort and the other areas that are available to them for support, that the government is not intending to move forward with a change in that at this point or after case transfer completes.
I appreciate the full answer. Would you accept that, you know, a bus pass is not quite the same as having a car or something else like that, which, you know, really gives you a lot of mobility? I mean, one, because in many areas there are no buses, so the bus pass is worth nothing. And I mean, if I take example of my mother latterly, her walking was so poor and she fell so often that going in a bus just became impossible for her. So yes, she had the bus pass, yes, she could go in it free, yes, there was a bus went past her door actually, but she still couldn't use the bus. And I suspect there's quite a lot of other people in that position.
I do absolutely take Mr Mason's point on this issue, and that's why I didn't just say there was the free bus travel, but there were other aspects around, including the areas of free personal care that can include support for immobility problems, and also, although I appreciate it may have not been of use to Mr Mason's mother, the entitlement to the Blue Badge scheme is there as well, although it's not an automatic entitlement from PDP. But there are different circumstances for this cohort compared to working age people, and that's why the decision has been taken at this time.
Should it be an automatic entitlement? That would be simpler.
Well, I think we need to look at the eligibility, and there's no mobility component for pension age disability payment. So it's challenging to see how local authorities could determine if an individual's mobility needs satisfy the Blue Badge criteria based on the pension age disability payment awards. And that's the same for attendance allowance as well. That's the reason why there's not the automatic entitlement process. In a recent meeting with Age Scotland, which I mentioned earlier, we did discuss the Blue Badge scheme and whether there's more can be done to assist people with knowledge about that scheme, and that although it's not an automatic entitlement, that it is still available for them to apply to. So what the agency will do is look at the reward letter which comes through after someone gets PADP, and that will signpost to information around the Blue Badge scheme and how an individual could apply for that. So while it's not automatic because there's no mobility component in the benefit itself, the agency will look to see what it can do after an award to signpost people to the Blue Badge scheme. And I'm happy to carry on that conversation with stakeholders to see if there's more that can be done to ease that process. So while it's not automatic, as we've discussed in committee before, I'm very keen on automation of benefits and moving people along as fastly as possible. But if that's not appropriate in this case, which I don't believe it is, then what more can we do? And I'm keen to carry on that conversation with them.
OK, thank you. And I mean, another angle on this is that there seems to be a bit of inconsistency around age sometimes, because if somebody applies for the mobility component just before they reach pension age, I understand it carries on then after they reach pension age, whereas if somebody applies after pension age, then they obviously can't get it at all. I mean, would you accept there is a bit of inconsistency, or there appears to be there?
I accept that's the way that the system is designed at the moment, and that we plan to continue with that. I go back to the point that there are different eligibility systems there for adult disability payment and for pension age disability payment, and we are very keen to ensure that we're not taking anything away from someone as the age. So it is fair to say that people that are receiving adult disability payment before they pass to state pension age will still receive the specific rate of the adult disability payment mobility components as long as they continue to satisfy that eligibility criteria, because we don't want to take something away from someone as they get older.
OK, I'll leave it at that just now. Thank you.
OK, thanks very much. Before I move on to the next theme, I believe Bob Dorris would like to come in with a supplementary.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Some quick start financial realities here, Cabinet Secretary. Some modest but very welcome changes for the new Scottish system has already seen an additional forecast cost of £87 million beyond the money provided from Westminster. And I think you've put on the record that the mobility component would cost £700 million and rising per annum to introduce. So eye-watering, I think, across party, we know it's just a non-starter, if I'm being really honest about it. However, there are lots of frail older people with mobility issues. Some will qualify for pension age disability payment, others won't. Now, I know money's not going to come available tomorrow. Convener, we're in a really, really difficult financial situation as a country and as a government. If money did become available, would it be sensible to bring an element of a mobility component for older people on that benefit? Or are there other ways we could use any new monies to help a lot of people who are struggling with mobility to get out and about and live active lives in older age? Are there other ways to invest other than through this mobility component?
So there certainly does not appear to be anything on the horizon that suggests to me that money is becoming available, although I am an optimist, as Mr Dorris knows, and if there is a change in government at a UK level, I do very much hope that they will not follow the financial constraints sent by the Conservative government and be able to have a better working relationship with the Scottish Government, and we can take those types of discussions forward. Mr Dorris makes one suggestion on that. I have a feeling, convener, if I was here discussing carer support payment, committee members would also suggest ways that we could spend that money on carer support, because there's quite rightly calls from carers' organisations to do more on that. So Mr Dorris is quite right. It is certainly something that could be considered in the future. They would need to be substantially, I think, different financial situations for the Scottish Government, given the sheer scale for the mobility component. Then what I would wish to do is, obviously in discussion with committee and with stakeholders, then look to see how that money could be spent. But there are, as I'm sure the committee will appreciate, a long list of things that people would wish me to do, and indeed I would wish to do myself, Mr Dorris, if the money became available.
For clarity, Cabinet Secretary, I wasn't suggesting that if £700 million became available, because it's simply not going to happen, that this would be how we'd spend it. The point I was making, Cabinet Secretary, that if a small amount of money was to become available, then there's lots of ways government can support frail older people to get mobile and live active life. So there are other demands on that money that can meet the needs that the mobility component is also supposed to be trying to meet the needs of. And would the Cabinet Secretary think innovatively about how we could do some of that?
I think it's a really interesting point the member raises, and it was one of the areas which I'm very grateful to stakeholders for discussing with me, because we didn't just discuss social security, but we discussed other ways to support older people. Some of that, yes, is through the transport system, and some of that can be potentially in other ways. But Mr Dorris is quite right to point out that social security is but one way to support people, and he's quite right to say that there may be other ways to do that that doesn't have the same eye-watering figure. Challenging still, nonetheless, in the financial constraints, but I think the approach that stakeholders have taken is to asking government to look at this in the round, and I've committed to doing that, as I think Mr Dorris is asking me to do as well.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you. If only we had a never-ending money pot, that would be fantastic. So anyway, thank you. So moving on to theme three, differences from attendance allowance, I'm going to invite Paul O'Kanan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary and officials. Last week, we took evidence from stakeholders, I suppose, in terms of their aspiration for the new benefit, and we heard some evidence about welcoming the aspiration that will be rooted, obviously, in that dignity, fairness and respect that we speak about, but I think also some kind of notes of caution around the experience, perhaps, in the transfer of other benefits and, indeed, wait times and things like that as well. So I suppose I just wanted to get a sense from the Cabinet Secretary of how the experience of applying for and receiving PADP is going to be different from attendance allowance as it currently stands.
So there are fundamental differences in that approach. One of them is, of course, the fact that there is an inclusive application support process. So, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, people can apply in the way that's right for them, which is different to the current system. And one of the other areas which we are very proud of in our social security system is, of course, the local delivery teams that are there to support people to apply for the benefits and to ensure, as best as they possibly can, that they're maximising what people can get by providing that support and ensuring that people are getting support to answer the application forms correctly and in full. The other area where we're very keen to make sure that we're making a real difference is, of course, around terminal illness. I've spoken about that earlier on too. And our approach to award reviews is also something that's been very much welcomed within what we've done already and devolved, to ensure that it's lighter touch, not as stressful, and therefore the individual has a lot greater dignity around that process as well. I'll give one further example of the difference that I think we can make, and that's around short-term assistance, and that's also unique to Scotland. So those are the improvements that will be made to ensure that applying for and getting attendance allowance is different. Mr O'Kane rightly points out that people will want to seek reassurance around the case transfer process and around processing times. I have said to committee and in the chamber to Mr O'Kane and others that processing times for CDP and ADP were too long. We are seeing a great deal of improvement in that. I've been through some of the reasons for that with committee, and all that lessons learned is of course been built into the design of what we do with PDP as we move forward.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Last week, committee heard about the 30-page form that exists for attendance allowance, and I heard the Cabinet Secretary make reference to, I suppose, the different formats of application for the Scottish benefit. Are you able to say how long the form is in terms of PADP, and I suppose to what extent have Social Security Scotland sort of tested that and worked with people to understand their needs within that?
So all of the forms that the agency have been co-designed with people that would be applying, and I mean literally I can remember for Best Start grants way back in the day I went along to one of these processes and we literally sat with women and took application forms apart and changed them, and this was a continual process of drafting and redrafting to ensure that the form itself is fit for purpose. We still need to learn once it goes live because there are changes that we've made, but that's the reassurance I can give around how the forms themselves are designed. We haven't concentrated on the length of the form, it's more around the usability of it, and if I can give some examples why I'm not really answering Mr. O'Kane's question directly, but some of the areas where we've been asked to look at in the past is around the fact that actually the questions have to be clearer, the questions need to be more spaced out, examples given. We've also made it easier to complete because when we've been going through that co-design process, that images are added onto the forms that we currently have already, because that's what people have said makes it easier for them to get those examples. So the form's still being formatted, it's not complete yet, but that's the type of process that we've been through before. So in essence, it may end up longer, but that's because it's been designed by the people who will be using it, because they wanted it more spaced out, they wanted examples to be given, they wanted images to be put in, and therefore easier to use. So it's the usability rather than the length, although obviously we keep in mind the length as we go through this as well. One caveat I'll give to that is obviously when you're applying online, the questions that you get are only the questions that relate to yourself. So if some of the answers would suggest another part of the form doesn't relate to you, then you don't have to go through that part of the form. So it's a work in progress, and we'll be happy to share that with committee once it's complete.
Okay, I appreciate that it's a work in progress, but you know, are you able to say if it is in the 30-page mark? It's just because Debbie Horn from Independent Age last week had said that the 30 pages are quite daunting for people. I mean, she did obviously qualify that by saying she appreciates that Scottish Government have looked at the alternative formats, and she actually thinks the delivery support will help people. But I think it is that sort of initial length of pages. So whilst I appreciate you might not want to give a figure, it's, are we in that sort of ballpark still?
I'm not able to say that at the moment because it's still going through that design process. But what I would give the absolute assurance on is every single page will have been tested with folk that have co-designed it with us, and they will have assisted us in working out how best to put that form in. So I'm sure that those who are concerned about that will. I won't say I'm sure. I am hopeful that given what we've done before in the last previous benefits, that people know that we design the forms with people and that it's designed because that's the way that the individuals themselves think is best process for designing. And we, of course, involve stakeholders in that as well. But happy to keep the committee updated on that as we go through that and the forms finalised.
Have you got any further questions?
If I could, just very briefly on short-term assistance. We heard a bit of evidence last week about some of SCOS's reservation about that in terms of its interaction with reserve benefits. And I know that there's an ongoing dialogue with the Scottish Government because there is a variance of view there. I just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary wanted to comment on that and in terms of those discussions moving forward.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the areas which is brand new to Scotland, something we're very proud of in Scotland. So I'm very keen to make sure that it is working effectively. and if there's differences of opinions and usability and views on that, then we're keen to see that. It's still quite a new system. What I would say is that it's not designed to replace disability benefits. It's there as a temporary payment to assist someone challenging a determination to reduce or cease their entitlement to a disability benefit. And the intention when SDA was being designed was to ensure that no one was discouraged from challenging a determination by having to manage for a period with a reduced income. So short-term assistance doesn't interact with the backdating of reserve benefits. If someone's successful in having their decision changed at redetermination or appeal, that doesn't affect that. But I appreciate that people are wanting us to look at that. They're wanting discussions to be had on that, and I'm very happy to carry that on with them to make sure that people feel that this system is being used as we intended it to, or if there's lessons that we can learn, what we can do from that.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay, thanks very much. And it was, I mean, our visit from the committee up to Social Security in Dundee, where we actually done a visual walkthrough of the ADP application, was really helpful. I think a lot of people benefited from seeing that, the members that attended that day. So it would be helpful to get an update as well based on the application and the co-design when it's complete as well. So thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd also wanted to explore, Cabinet Secretary, short-term assistance. I listened very carefully to the exchange with Paul O'Kane. I think the committee would welcome maybe just a note about all the areas that short-term assistance would be actually be a passported benefit for in relation to UK reserve benefits, so we can understand, if you like, the extent of the exposure of the DWP taking a different view to having STA as a passported benefit as opposed to retrospectively claiming back once benefit is reinstated. But I know that one of those benefits is the suite of carers benefits that exist as a passported benefit, but my understanding is by the autumn of this year that will be wholly delivered by Social Security Scotland. So I'm just wondering, in relation to a Scotland-specific system of passported benefits, if someone gets short-term assistance in relation to pensionage disability payment and they get STA, would they get their carers' payments passported at a Scottish level, or would they have to apply to Social Security Scotland to get that backdated to the point where they would have otherwise been available? Because passporting is increasingly not just at a UK level, but also at a Scottish level as well.
So if Mr Dorris is content, I'm happy to get back to him further in writing around the passporting benefits and short-term assistance in particular. What I would go back to when it comes to short-term assistance is that it's, yes, it's unique to Scotland. Its intention is there to ensure that no one is discouraged from challenging a decision. It is not in itself an award of a benefit, and that's the difference that makes. So there is a nuance of approach between what happens when you're receiving short-term assistance to when you're receiving a benefit. But I'm happy to provide that in writing, particularly around the carers element, as I appreciate he's saying that's passporting to another part of the devolved system, not passporting into the reserve system. So I can provide that, provide more detail in writing about how that would work and talk the committee through that process.
I think that would be really helpful, Cabinet Secretary, because the committee can't start to call for things. We don't actually realise the granular detail of what it means in practice. And it might be that we believe at some point in the future, short-term assistance, the state of it should change to being a standalone passport benefit for a short period of time. I don't know. But unless we can map out what that looks like, the committee cannot make an informed decision. So that note, I think, would be welcome. The only other question I had, you've touched on already, Cabinet Secretary, and that was about lessons learned from the rollout of other benefits. Do you want to add anything in relation to that, in particular around the capacity to process applications or perhaps being able to respond to clients within a reasonable time? I know you've mentioned some of this already, Cabset, but it's an opportunity to put some maybe more on the record, some reassurance on that.
Well, I think it is very important that the committee has reassurance that the agency has undertaken a great deal of work to improve processing times. It's something which I keep an extremely close eye on, and I'm in very close dialogue with the agency on. I'm very much welcome the changes that they've made to their processing to ensure that that is a quicker speed. I hope the members that went up to Agnes Husband House saw that in real time and got discussed through in greater detail the amount of changes that have been made and are continuing to be made around that. So the capacity is very much there. The lessons have been learnt and are continuing to be learnt. Again, I'm sure the agency would be more than happy to host the committee in the future to be talked through either any of the further work that's been done on processing times or indeed anything else, or when we get to the point of PDP being live.
Thank you.
Perhaps not in the first week, though. We'll allow them some time for that.
Will we give it a couple of weeks, Cabinet Secretary? OK, thank you. No more questions.
Thank you very much, and you'll be pleased to know that we're moving on to our last theme, which is improving take-up, and I'm going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. Just come back to SDA, and obviously our spice briefing suggests that, you know, we ask the Scottish Government, but do you agree it's kind of more a question to ask the UK Government about, if anyone at all?
I think it's both because of the point that Mr Doris quite rightly raises about some of it's now passporting to another part of the social security system up here and some of it's down to a reserve benefit. And also the fact that we were clear when we designed ST that it is not in itself a benefit. So I think it's a question for both governments, but it's certainly one that the Scottish Government absolutely should be live to, given that we set up SDA on a particular premise. So, yes, there's a question for the UK Government, but I wouldn't shirk the responsibility that we have to look at that too.
Thank you for that. Moving on to kind of uptake as well, I mean, what are the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland doing to encourage take-up of the pension age disability payment?
Well, I mentioned in my opening remarks the very great importance that we put on ensuring that people are encouraged to apply for benefits that they may be eligible for. The committee will be well aware, and I believe has heard evidence over the really concerning level of benefit uptake in certain reserved benefits for older people, pension credit being the most obvious. So we're very keen that we can do everything that we can. One of the areas where we're already seeing that in the systems that we have is because the system is seen to be easier to apply for. It's seen to be a more dignified application and assessment process, and therefore people are more confident in applying. And I heard that directly when I was on a recent visit when we talked about CDP and the fact that the parents themselves were talking amongst themselves about how within a school community information had been shared about how easy the process had been, and therefore it had encouraged people to do that. That's exactly the type of process we then want to see around pension age disability payment as well. So how do we do that? We do similar things to what we've done already for other benefits, particularly for when we launch pilots. We're very keen to make sure that we are engaging with the local authorities that are involved in those pilot schemes to ensure that they are fully up to speed with what's happening and they can support, and obviously our third sector partners in all of those pilot schemes as well. So, as the committee would expect, there's very regular sessions that happen as we go through the build-up to a pilot, and then once pilot launches. There's also obviously the further work that in essence sits outside the social security system, but is very important, such as the welfare advice and health partnerships that see welfare rights advisers placed in 160 GP practices. And there's also the work that is ongoing to ensure that we are challenging ourselves as we look at uptake to not just look for those that are perhaps the easiest to encourage, but we're also looking at seldom heard groups. So our approach to tackling those additional barriers that those groups face will be assisted, I hope, when we publish a seldom heard groups action plan later this year.
Thanks. I welcome that. I'm aware of a joint initiative between the Climate Asbestos Group and Trade Unions Unite, I think it is, in Unison. They're sort of retired members of the branch, and they're obviously trying to promote the uptake of attendance allowance amongst their members. Would you or your officials be kind of willing to meet with them just to hear about their efforts and how, you know, the Scottish Government can assist them?
We'd be delighted to take up that suggestion. Anything that we can do with any stakeholder and with any interested party to assist an uptake would be greatly welcome. So happy to follow that up with Ms McNair after the committee.
Thanks for that. Also, in what ways are the Social Security Scotland processing been able to adapt to take into consideration, you know, the needs of the older clients that are obviously applying for this benefit?
So I've talked through some of that already, so I won't repeat those, but I'll touch on one and expand slightly, and that's the importance of the local delivery team. We really do see that as a key difference between DWP and the way that the system is set up here. The ability for our local delivery staff to be available right throughout the community, not just sitting in an office somewhere waiting for people to come to them, but going out into to libraries, schools, community settings, to be able to meet people directly, but also to be able to go directly to people's homes should they wish to receive that support in the home, I think is vital, perhaps particularly, but not just for this age group. It is a service that's available to all clients and not just those even that are applying for disability benefits. So I would point to the local delivery teams as something which I really do feel was a point of the system that was set up right at the start, that was absolutely designed to improve uptake, and I hope this is really where it comes into its own.
Like my colleague Paul McKay said earlier on, obviously, you know, it's getting the form right. You know, obviously, you know, the 30 pages that's been mentioned, so we can maybe try and adapt it a wee bit. Just kind of moving on, just one final question, convener. Obviously, the kind of UK government have launched a green paper, you know, the plans to overhaul the current disability system. And obviously, there's a few worrying options been mentioned, you know, about regular payments, such as one-off grants and vouchers. Can I seek assurances from you that that's not an approach that we'll take in Scotland?
Briefly, no, it's not. For the benefit of further detail, I have raised those concerns with the UK government. I am greatly concerned that it is exactly the opposite of what we're trying to do, which is if people have a long-term condition or a disability, they should be actively encouraged to apply what they are entitled to, and we should support people in this process. And it goes back to that fundamental principle that Social Security is a human right. It's an investment in our people, and the government has absolutely no intention of deviating from that course.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I appreciate your reassurances. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks very much, and I very much appreciate questions and answers. I'm now going to move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M12904, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Disability Assistance for Older People Scotland Regulations 2024 draft be approved. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and to move the motion.
Moved, convener.
Thank you. I now invite contributions from members. Okay. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to the debate.
I think I'm fine, convener.
There's no debate, sorry. I know, sorry. Speaking from script there, so sorry about that. Anyway, thank you. So the question is that motion S6M12904 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville, be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So the committee will report on the outcome of the instrument in due course, and a draft report will be prepared by the clerks. Are members content to consider this draft report in private at next week's meeting?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you to your officials as well. This concludes our business for today, and I formally close the meeting. Thank you.